here with me, Amaya, on a Monday morning. Now, there are so many Mondays that are coming up in 2014. It's just gotten to be like just another year and just another day now. Like, in the beginning of the year, we were all very excited about what's coming up for the rest of the year. But now it's mid-January and everyone's kind of gone back to the same routine. I hope that those of you who are able to keep the New Year resolutions that they made at the beginning of the year have been, you know, okay with the managing that.
It's just 17 days down the line, or 20.
It feels very mundane now, but good morning.
Good morning.
We have Anupama back on the show with us after a very, very long absence. What have you been up to, Anupama?
After weeks. After 4 weeks.
Yeah. 4 weeks, I think so.
Yeah. So I've been studying. I've been very nerdy. Engrossed in books and stuff like that. It's been a good month, but then unlike everybody else,
But now you've joined civilization again.
I know. I've got out of my nerdiness and joined civilization again. We were discussing something interesting before the show began, remember?
What was
insects.
That? Insects. Insects. Yes. I don't know whether leeches qualify as insects.
I don't know.
But I don't think they do. They're not flying objects, that's for sure. But I had my first leech attack experience
last weekend. Yes,
yeah, ever.
Is that your first leech experience?
First leech experience. Okay. I'm kind of proud of myself. I took a picture of the bite and put it up on Facebook and said, "Look, leech has attacked me." Right. But we have a very interesting guest with us this morning.
Who despises insects? That's why we brought it up, actually.
And we're hoping that nothing untoward suddenly crops up in our studio.
Yes.
But she's a lovely lady. She's a very bubbly personality. And she's someone who is just under 25 years of age. But she's making waves here in Sri Lanka. And she's someone who strongly represents being Sri Lankan, as well as being a true citizen of our country. And we'll ask her more about her opinions on these things later. Now, she is a research analyst here in Sri Lanka. And she's also finished her LLB. And she's continuing further studies.
And she's a writer.
And she's a very interesting writer. Yes. She has her own blog, which many people follow. And we have her with us on the show this morning, Sharanya Sekaram.
Hi, good morning.
Hi.
Good morning. It's lovely to have you on the show.
It's lovely to be here.
Did you spot any insects around?
No. I did a quick scan when I walked into the room. And I'm like, no, nature is safely outside, right?
I see. Okay, all right. We can arrange something, though.
No, thank you. Generous.
But,
you know, I think we should run and get through the show without me shrieking.
Yeah. All right, okay.
That'll be a good way to start.
So you're someone who is involved with a lot of national policy making as well, and you work as a research analyst.
Yeah,
let's
right.
talk a bit about the type of work you do.
Okay, so the Kadargama Institute was started by the late Lakshman Kadargama. Mm-hmm. His idea was to have a multidisciplinary institute which formulates policy for the Sri Lankan government and, you know, deals with international policy making and international links. So the institute was fairly defunct after he died for a while, and in 2011 it was revived.
Mm-hmm.
I've been working there for about 8 months now.
Mm-hmm.
I love it. I'm one of those few people who genuinely say I love my job.
Okay.
So I'm a research analyst there, which, you know, we work on our individual areas of research. We, because it comes under the foreign ministry, we also have a lot of international liaising that we do. And we also organize a lot of events because we attempt to be a place for discussion and debate. So we have a lot of events, seminars, public lectures, national conferences, various okay. things. So it's an incredibly interesting job to have.
And it's an amazing forum. I mean, the people that you can meet and the ideas and the voices that are exchanged.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Between the in that particular platform.
Oh yeah.
Must be
what
an amazing
led you
experience.
To be there? What led you to join the Kadargama Institute?
Well, I used to go for events to the Kadargama Institute.
While you were schooling?
While I was at college.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Not while I was schooling. While I was at college. And when I was drawing towards the end of my LLB, I was going through these panic attacks. I didn't know what I wanted to do. And I was like, oh my God. And then it was my father where I wanted to do research. My father suggested, okay, there are these institutes. Why don't you have a look and think about it? And I went for an event. I was introduced to the executive director. And I was chatting with him. And he said, okay, why don't you come in for an interview since you're so interested? And that's kind of how it happened. He interviewed me and he said, okay, we have an opening for an internship.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, okay, why not, you know, kind of take the first step. And then from the internship, I went into a permanent position. And yeah, it's been an incredible 8 months. It's opened up hundreds and hundreds of doors, and I've met such amazing people through the institute. Mm-hmm. So
And you can see that you genuinely do love your job. Like when she talks about it, you can see the sort of...
Not paid to say that.
Yeah. I'm not.
No, I'm really not.
I'm sure. Yeah, but you know, you mentioned earlier that while doing your LLB, you were not sure about what you were going to do in the future. Yeah. So, like if most of the other people who do an LLB, you didn't want to be a lawyer?
No, it's a question people ask me all the time. Oh, so you must be a lawyer. And I'm like, not really. Which is funny because my mother is a practicing lawyer. Mm-hmm. And she is the one who strongly encouraged me to do an LLB. I was very against it in the beginning, actually. Now she can happily say, I told you so. Mother's greatest dream.
To say, I told you so.
To say, I told you so.
Yes.
But the thing is, most people confuse it. An LLB is an academic degree. Yes. So like any other academic degree, you know, you kind of look at the surroundings of the law, you know, you look at history, sociology, politics, international relations. So when I started doing it, you don't just study the law per se, you study why the law exists, how does it relate to society, why has this particular law come about, what are the changes, how does our law differ from other countries. Mm-hmm. So you kind of engage with it. And the first couple of years I focused on the degree, and then coming towards my third year I was like, okay, now I'm not really sure where I want to take this. Because, well, you know, a law degree is one of the most competitive and difficult degrees to obtain.
Definitely, yeah.
So when you do go into the working world, whether it's the corporate sector or, you know, the legal practicing field or research, mm-hmm. you command a certain respect when you say you have an LLB. Because they know it's not easy. They know it hasn't been an easy 3 years. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Not discounting any other, no degree is easy. But law has, you know, it's up there with medicine, architecture, accountancy. You know, they're tough degrees. They're very difficult to get through over those 3 years. So when you do go to a prospective employer and you say, I have a law degree, you do command, because they're like, okay, so she suffered for 3 years. She got through it. There must be
and
something.
Not only did she get through it, you got through it with honors, if I'm not mistaken.
And so then, in my final year, I elected to do a thesis. Mm-hmm. So I did a dissertation project on media and the law. It was fabulous. It was so interesting. I thoroughly immersed myself in it. And that kind of led to me wanting to explore research and see what research took me, and mm-hmm. so far it's been great. I'm really enjoying doing it, kind of immersing yourself in a subject. It's amazing.
So do you have any particular area of interest that you really try to focus on? Or because when you say international relations or international affairs or even national affairs,
yeah.
it's a wide spectrum.
Oh yeah, definitely.
So what's your real target and what are you really interested in?
At the moment I'm working on a paper which is about sustainable development in post-conflict economies.
Oh, okay.
So it sounds really fancy, but it's essentially looking at economies or countries that have just come out of conflict. Not just Sri Lanka, but several, Afghanistan, Iran, different places, and kind of looking at how do they rebuild themselves to be sustainable and so that conflict doesn't happen again, mm-hmm. and that kind of thing. So, and I'm also kind of wavering into women's affairs now. So I'm working on a paper consecutively on women's political participation in Sri Lanka.
Oh, God.
So it's a very interesting
whole different subject itself.
Yeah.
And you're just stepping into it.
I'm talking about sustainable development, so is that why you were interested in the UMT?
UMT was, well, I wanted to do reconciliation work once I left college. Again, UMT is something I find I walk into things.
This is a Unity Mission Trust,
yes,
right?
Yes.
So those of you who don't know, Unity Mission Trust is a non-profit organization.
It's a not-for-profit trust which fosters unity, healing, reconciliation and integration with youth from all over the country. Okay. So we work with youth primarily. It's an amazing organization now in almost its fifth year of operations. Mm-hmm. It has, we've connected with almost, I believe, over 4,000 students are part of our network now. We've done six unity camps, ongoing amazing projects that really are transforming lives. So again, I met Mr. Bertil Pinto Jayawardena at the Kabir Gram Institute before I started working there, and got involved with the organization, and it's become a hugely integral part of who I am, what I do. Mm-hmm. I see myself there actually long term, no matter where I am or what I'm doing. I will always, because this organization it's touched 4,000 lives, and then it's touched the 600 odd lives of the volunteers who've been part of it.
I have
completely changed as a person being a part of this organization.
So the type of work you do is always involved, is it always the North and the East and reconciliation and sort of the social integration of the children there?
Yeah, so we have several ongoing projects. There are mm-hmm. English classes that happen in the Wanni area. There are ongoing educational scholarships that people have funded.
Okay.
We do one-day refresher programs for former campers. Then our main mm-hmm. flagship event event is the Unity Camps, which happen once a year. So in October of last year, we concluded the camp in Kilinochi. And then in September of this year, we'll be doing a camp in Tangal. So you bring 600 kids from all over the country. It's camp is an something that you have to experience, because you don't think 4 days can change someone or their perspective. You could not be more wrong.
So when you went into it, you really didn't expect that what you experienced during those 4 days.
I was part of the organization for about 3-4 months before my first camp. And I was a believer in the work that they did. I was a believer in, you know, that they did touch and transform lives. But I don't think I was 100% convinced that you have kids who come on the first day of camp, who are separated from their friends, who are put in groups where they don't speak each other's language, who are crying. And, you know, my first day, I was like, yeah, okay, I don't see how these kids are going to be, you know, happy for the next 4 days. And then you kind of watch them over the 4 days completely transform. It's, you can see it happening. And then on the fourth day, they're crying again, this time in their groups, this time in, with kids, they don't speak the same language. They're from completely different parts of the country, and but they're hugging each other and crying. And they, and I've seen these friendships continue. I've seen them, you know, because you have their Facebook. So, you know, so you see how they're connected to each other, and they're waiting for the next event. They're connected to the organization. They're messaging you and saying, you know, when is the next event? We want to see everyone again. And 4 days can completely transform.
Wow. So we have so much more to talk with you, Sharanya, about. And we're speaking to someone who's making waves here in Sri Lanka in her own special way. And we're speaking to Sharanya Sekaram. We'll be right back after the break with more on Good Morning Sri Lanka.